Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. So let's begin by dissecting the news. Today, most Filipinos mark 49 years since the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos placed the Philippines under martial law, one of the darkest episodes in our country's history, where thousands were killed and billions of dollars in public money were stolen by Marcos and their cronies. But in remembering and making sure that we'll all learn important lessons from the past, accuracy is required and is most important. Tonight, we'll talk about this fiction long propagated by Marcos that martial law was declared on September 21st, when in fact, he proclaimed it 2 days later. And just as important, the present generation's continuing struggle against persistent efforts to distort the truth about martial law and deodorize the image of the Marcoses. Now, be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Joining us tonight, historian and former Presidential Communications Undersecretary Manolo Quezon. Also with us is human rights lawyer Nery Colmenares. He's also a convener of KARMA, or the Campaign Against the Return of the Marcoses to Malacanang. Good evening, gentlemen, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening, good evening, Manolo.
Okay, I'll start with Manolo. Every year, you keep doing this, correcting this this erroneous commemoration of martial law. Okay, again, what is the correct date? Why it's supposed to be September 23, not September 21, and why the difference is big and why it matters?
Yes, okay. It started by interviewing people who fought against Marcos. And we know when the date that they were picked up, and it was, you know, depending on who you were picked up shortly before midnight or after midnight, as September 22 turned into 23. So logically, it led to the question, if that's when they were arrested, what was happening on September 21? And when you look back, September 21 was interesting because three things were happening. First, there was a rally in Plaza Miranda in which 30,000 people participated. Second, Ninoy Aquino made his last privileged speech in the Senate warning that there would be martial law in 48 hours. Third, Marcos, in his own diary, said two groups came to visit him that day, worried that there was going to be martial law. One was the group of the Northern Bloc of congressmen, as he called it, meaning his fellow Ilocanos in Congress. And the second was the U.S. ambassador, who somehow had gotten a copy of the proclamation. So, makes you wonder, when I was interviewing people, they said, nung martial law nung September 21. And I said, really? And the fact that I had to question people who lived through it and get to the point where they go, ay, oo nga pala, no? And because you have to jog their memory, that is how good and how effective Marcos's propaganda was. The propaganda was, you know, he himself backdating his proclamation and then making it Thanksgiving Day so that even Marcos's enemies to this day, all the critics of Marcos pay him homage by accepting the founding lie of the martial law regime.
But why did Marcos have to backdate that? September 21.
The common reason given is because he was superstitious, which he was, and therefore he wanted a date divisible by seven. But of course, that is only half of the story. The practical reason was Congress was due to adjourn. In those days, Congress would be in adjournment around September, and then the Congress would resume in January. The SONA in those days used to be in January, unlike July, which is when we start the legislative. So Marcos had to ensure that there would be no congressional bodies in session to potentially challenge a proclamation of martial law. And it also, by the way, the reason why he had to change the Constitution by January 1973 to prevent Congress convening. So there was a practical reason.
Okay. One is superstition, the other is practical. Okay.
Yes.
Attorney Colmenares, as a convener and, of course, an activist, longtime activist, is this a big deal to you? And does this really matter, the difference between September 21 and 23?
I knew about September 23 for quite some time now, years now. But I've always thought that he signed the proclamation on September 21, and because he planned a blitzkrieg, you know, so it took him like 2 days to really declare it. It was in secret. That was my previous belief. Now, Manolo is trying to explain it, so it's probably true. But my belief then was that, he signed the proclamation September 21, but he didn't want to disturb things. He wanted everything in place so that on September 23, everybody will be arrested. You know, the whereabouts of Aquino and Yokno and so on, all the activists and so on. So, yeah, but he actually thought about it on September. I don't really know the story now, because if he did declare it in September 23, I just presume that he prepared for it long before. So I wouldn't be surprised if he really signed it on September 21, because there was this plan already months before. In fact, they say a year before martial law was planned. So,
but legally, Attorney Colmenares, if document was signed on the 21st, and then the proclamation was done 2 days later, I mean,
yes. Okay.
The strength of that proclamation as to the actions taken by the government, for example, the suspension of the privilege of the writ, if people were arrested on the 21st?
No, no, there were no arrests that I know of now from Manolo's statement. But I always thought that he didn't really arrest people on the 21st because he was waiting for everything in place. So that once September 23, 2 days later, everything is in place, they can swoop down and arrest as many opposition members, as many activists on the 23rd, rather than, you know, once you sign it, then you piecemeal arrest somebody. He'd rather do everything at once at the time. Like a blitzkrieg, as I say.
Para hindi mabulaga yung mga gustong arrest.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, Christian, there's a very interesting point that Raisa Robles pointed out. Because, of course, for lawyers, the document speaks for itself, right?
Yeah.
But the thing was, besides the very interesting story, I mean, for people like me, about how you can have basically a bit of evidence to show that he didn't sign it on the 21st. The other thing is, remember, what the reason that we focus on the 21st is, actually, by any score, it was illegitimate, it was illegal, and besides those grounds, it was purely a self-coup. It was a coup d'etat by any other name. And we know this again because Marcos, of course, tended to brag in his own diary, and he basically had to threaten the Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court wanted to review the basis for martial law, whether it was in keeping with the Constitution. And he said, well, if you do that, I'll proclaim a revolutionary government. And all of a sudden, they backed off. But, you know, we have other things that, for example, Executive Secretary Melchor was supposed to countersign the document. And we know it wasn't on September 21, because that was when Melchor went to the United States. He went to the United States because Marcos was not sure if Melchor would support martial law, because he had actually formally told Marcos that he had misgivings about it. And then, of course, Marcos himself kept changing his story, and the only other witness who's still alive is Juan Ponce Enrile, and he, you know how he keeps changing his stories. But yeah. Basically, if you look at any of their stories, as Neric pointed out, Marcos was planning this since 1969. The question was not if, but when. Mm. But then the when matters, because precisely I guess I'm an extremist in the sense that you cannot concede even the chronology to Marcos. That's a very dangerous road that then gets you into useless arguments about, well, was he sincere at the time, or was it something that was allowed? No, you have to argue because there were lives that were cost and the whole direction of the country was changed, that he was not entitled to do this. It was a coup. It was a decision that cost a whole generation of our country its best and brightest.
Okay, but if the document was dated September 21st, the proclamation was done 2 days after, why did a fake ambush have to be staged in between?
Precisely, because then here we have, for whatever it's worth, the two facts. One fact is Congress, which is the most inefficient group of people in the world, couldn't stick to their own schedule, which is why Marcos's plan for September 21 couldn't push through. That's one main reason. The other reason is, of course, everyone was chismoso. And, you know, one thing that friend or foe said about Ninoy was he had incredibly good intel. And he was telling everyone what the schedule was. And Marcos was saying, if this guy knows, we're doomed. And so they had to come up with a better reason than just out of the surprise. So they had to pretend that there was an ambush, and that gave the reason for Marcos to jump the gun, so to speak, even ahead of his own schedule.
Okay. Attorney Colmenares, according to Manolo, by recognizing September 21st, 1972, as the anniversary of martial law, we're actually paying homage to the late dictator and basically consuming his narrative for lies. So do you think it's really time to fix the state once and for all and acknowledge the 23rd?
Yeah, maybe for historical purposes, it's nice to, of course, do that. But as Manolo mentioned, you know, the document, usually for lawyers like me, speaks for itself. In any case, if we all agree that he did plan it a long time ago, and he probably signed it on September 21, he declared it on September 23 and arrested everybody, the essence is still the same. He declared martial law and then arrested everybody, closed Congress. So yeah, maybe what Manolo is saying is he signed September 21, then, oh, Congress is not yet in recess, so let's not move now. Let's wait. We need to convince people about the need of this. Oh, let's stage an ambush then. So it was a well-planned planned thing. And the fact that they declared or imposed it on the 23rd or in the 25th, well, probably, you know, it depends on the situation. But, you know, it didn't matter in the sense that it ended the same way. Tyranny and dictatorship on the part of Marcos and extreme poverty and, you know, human rights violations under him during that time.
Okay. So Manuel, how do we fix this?
Well, you know, I do think you have to make a decision. The memory of the country was robbed of essentially two precious days of freedom, and that's no small matter. It shows you that the ambition of Marcos was so total that it was going to change time itself. That the recognition of the totality, that is why you call this a totalitarian regime, was so total that you have to confront it. You have to also, in many ways, remove the power from the date that he himself placed on that date. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, to concede it is already to lose half the battle to the Marcoses. You have to point out by that there was a founding lie, mm-hmm. and that you have to reject that lie. And from all of that, all the other lies fall down like a domino. On the other hand, there is no reason why you cannot have, you know, personally, for me, you have 2 or 3 days of recollection, because the country cannot have too little recollection. We must remember the continuum, that there is the date that the dictator chose for his own reasons, but the actual date when the people ended up being put in jail for the crime of having independent minds. And the one, I think, to focus on the 21st diminishes the 23rd very much.
Okay. So basically, this inaccuracy, to use a very light term, but basically this lie is in keeping with the totalitarian regime. Now, let's talk about the other big lies of the Marcos dictatorship that remain until today, which are just as important. Attorney Neri, you've been hearing all this information or disinformation being propagated by supporters of the late dictator and his family today. What for you are some of the biggest lies about Marcos, about martial law, that need to be addressed squarely?
Well, one of the biggest lies, of course, is the Golden Age theory they have, that it was the Golden Age. people are very poor. I'm not going to talk now immediately about human rights violation, just the economic poverty of the people. I come from Negros, and if people search the internet now, maybe Joel Abong will come up. The name of Joel Abong, he was a child who was the face of famine in Negros. Can you imagine that, Christian? There was famine in Negros, and children are dying because of malnutrition. I remember I was a young kid, and my mother would give me a coupon because there were no rice to buy. There was no rice to buy. So I have to line up in the, I forgot now, the barangay or the palengke maybe, and could only buy at least one ganta of rice for our family. So is that golden age? There's no rice to be bought. And then about 2 weeks later, I remember that there were no more rice to be bought. So they were rationing corn. And when I brought, you know, the corn at home, my mother cried because she said, I never thought I would feed my children corn. Because, you know, we were kids, we were young. So we were complaining, we don't want to eat corn. We were crying and so on. But my mother was really hurt by that. So is that the golden age? When people are hungry, Imelda Marcos builds the cultural center, the PICC. Well, will the cultural center be good? Yeah, maybe. But at the time, the priority need is hunger. And the priority need are the farmers, the sakadas, cannot even afford to buy their own sugar. And they, you know, built all these hundreds of mills. So poverty was there. And when people complain because of poverty, when workers complain because of low wages, because they could not feed their family, they're being, you know, arrested, tortured, and killed. So that's not the golden age. If they say it's the golden age, none of us, not even them, would want to live in that kind of society. So
how about the narrative of the Marcos supporters that you also often hear, that martial law was only bad for the communists? If you were not a communist at that time, you had nothing to worry about. You had nothing to be afraid of. Similar to arguments that were used in some parts of Latin America during that period. Attorney Nery.
Yeah, well, actually, it's the ordinary people who were really devastated by this. I don't know, I was in the elementary at the time, but I think the communists and the CPP NPA were not very big then. I think they were in the mountains. They probably did suffer too over there. But the people in the urban areas and, well, in the rural areas also, in, you know, far-flung provinces, they suffered a lot. Because the issue of wages, for example, doesn't really affect, you know, other people except the workers. The issue of famine and you know, is an issue of ordinary people. So they cannot say that, if it is the communists who suffered a lot, 2 million people went to EDSA, 3 million people went to EDSA because of nothing, because trip lang nila na mag-EDSA. No. People go out in the streets risking their lives because you can be shot during that time when you go to rallies. They went there because there is a cause. There is poverty, there is hunger, there's corruption, and there's human rights violation. The people will not go out to EDSA and, you know, risk their lives of being stepped upon by tanks and shot by helicopters without a cause. Yeah. So that's really bad for the Marcos apologies to say that EDSA was nothing more than, you know, an overthrow of a good president. EDSA was recognized the world over as a historic struggle of a people who went out there, risked their lives, and ousted the dictator. Now they're going to reduce it to something like, oh, it's a fake, it was a fake revolution, so to speak. So that's really an insult to the injury of the many people who went to EDSA and the many people who died because of the atrocities of Marcos.
Okay. Manolo, again, we're still in the context of the talking about the myths and the lies about martial law. Kaya ako naitanong yan yung ano, kung hindi ka naman komunista, wala kang dapat ikinatakot yan. Because I myself have been hearing from some old-timers during that time na sinasabi.
You know why that argument
takot, takot
is...
lang sila sa komunista eh. Ay, takot lang dyan ang mga komunista.
You know why that argument is very powerful, Christian? Because the one thing that we have not been good at discussing because of EDSA, the EDSA story for 30 years dominated as the Filipino people freeing themselves. And with that expulsion of the Marcoses came forgiveness for the country. The country where I would argue the majority, particularly of the middle and the upper classes, were 100% behind Marcos for a very long time. So that's the thing. You know, as they always say, you know, you have to have a kernel of truth even to push a big lie. And one of the reasons that the Marcos revisionist propaganda is so good is it taps into these sort of unresolved, because very messy realities. One of them was the fact that, you know, Marcos did tap into something that managed him to get away with behavior that none of his predecessors and successors have managed. Marcos tapped into something so that even after all everything that's happened, there is a fierce minority, not the majority, a fierce minority that is still committed to him. On the other hand, those who whether from the very start or very late in the game, got to the point of wanting Marcos out, have not resolved what should be our kind of way of dealing with this reality.
Are you seeing that same playbook now?
It's the universal playbook. The one thing that we forget is that, to my mind, many of these comparisons are no longer valid because what Marcos did was new, which is one reason he got away with it. It's now actually rather tame compared to, I think it's a bit worse in some ways, in that in 5 years, you don't even have to lock up too many people. It turns out all you have to do is, you know, just speak a certain way and everyone rolls over to have their tummies rubbed by Malacañang. It's worse. You know, there were people agonizing over what they would do in the face of Marcos in 1972. I don't think there was much agonizing this time around, you know. So and that's because we get sort of manhid to leaders pushing the envelope. And what was even 10 years ago, 5 years ago, impossible for a president to get away with, presidents can get away with now.
Okay.
Okay,
go ahead, Attorney Neri.
Yes, the other counter to that narrative that komunista lang ang natamaan ng martial law. Marcos used to call everybody, all dissenters and activists, CPP and PA. If I remember right, Benigno Aquino, Senator Jokno, Tanya, all of them are CPP and PA. In fact, the military commission that tried Aquino, well, together with John Macison, Bernabe Buscaido. So for example, so everybody there that's against Marcos is a CPP and PA. And I remember I was at 18 years old, I became the chairman of the Student Catholic Action. And our main demand then was the return of Student Council and school papers. I was at NPA, but yet they arrested an 18-year-old and tortured me heavily for 6 to 7 days. And I languished in prison for a total of about 4 years. I never stole anything. I never shot anybody. I never harmed anybody. And yet I was the recipient of a brutal torture. Does that mean that he was only aiming it at the CPP and PA? No, he was aiming it at all dissenters. Whether you're in Congress, whether you're in media, whether you're ABS-CBN, or you're a priest, or you're a bishop, you're a student activist, doesn't matter. Do not go against Marcos because we will arrest you. We will even execute you, like salvaging for that matter. So I think we are the living proof that the atrocities of Marcos were actually committed on ordinary people. Ordinary people who were merely espousing their advocacies for a better Philippines.
And again, we're seeing the same playbook here, right? Using the red label, red baiting as a convenient excuse to go after enemies.
Yes, there is a lot of similarity between President Marcos and President Duterte. They both came to power on the virtue of their promises of change. Both of them. Secondly, the military litters the government because, of course, martial law during Marcos, now undeclared martial law during Duterte, littered in military. And then red tagging all dissenters, whether you're a priest, you're ABS-CBN, you're a community pantry, you're a celebrity, everybody. So that's the problem with this, because the moment you charge everybody a CPP and PA, then the narrative that, only the communists are affected here. When in fact, the real story is these are not communists, they are not NPAs, but they were red tagged precisely because they are merely dissenting or opposing policies of President Duterte or President Marcos for that matter.
Okay, let's go to the other big lie that is still being propagated to this day. the idea that nothing has been proven about the alleged or the ill-gotten wealth amassed by the Marcoses. Manolo, let's talk about this.
Well, I mean, you know, just today we were tweeting and there's an infographic on the Official Gazette. There have been many, many cases and many forfeitures that have been won. We forget, for example, that the reason Imelda Marcos was able to come home in 1991 was because the Swiss demanded that she be allowed to face her accusers in the Philippines over the question of her Swiss deposits as part of the, because it was required by the European Convention on Human Rights. And we forget, and of course the Marcoses don't remind anyone that they lost, the Marcoses lost that case, and that that money has been earmarked for the restitution of victims. There have been many cases won, too many cases lost, and too many cases probably lost because of, you know, the Marcoses can buy all the best legal advice and more available. But it's not a question. They have lost cases. They are convicts under, you know, multiple jurisdictions, as a lawyer like Nerick would point out, in the United States, in the Philippines, and other places. Of course, the Marcoses are not propagandizing this and not admitting it. Yes, and most importantly of all, they are not in jail. So they can say, look at us. But beyond that, I think, and of course, there is one more factor, which is, I think, the really problematic one. In our culture, election is absolution. So anyone who wins an election uses it to say, I have been absolved by the Filipino people of all these charges. And it is one that we really have to confront as one of the shortcomings of the governments we've been under since 1986.
Okay, let's go to another very basic conviction or case. Imelda Marcos was convicted in 2018. Marami nagtatanong, bakit di pa siya nakakulong? Attorney Nery.
Well, she appealed, and because of her appeal, there was a consideration of her age and humanitarian and so on. In fact, she would not have had the right to appeal because she missed the deadline for filing appeal. If it were Nery Colmenares who would have filed a late appeal, I don't think I will get somewhere. But you see, it's really skewed in favor of the Marcoses here. And it's a big lie for them to say that, this never been proven. Republic versus Sandigan Bayan said, the Supreme Court even said, we totaled all your income since you were a senator in 1986 when you were overthrown. It totals to $304,000. So how come you have $350 million in the Swiss banks? Yeah. Is that not proof enough? Marcos versus Manglapos, the Supreme Court said you are a dictator and a plunderer. So all these things were there. The fact that there is corruption in PCGG, and I'm very open about this, there was corruption in PCGG and they lost the case, does not erase the historical fact that Marcos plundered the country and the Marcoses contributed to human rights violations. The fact, Christian, that a law was passed by Congress, 10 billion pesos to the victims of Marcos's human rights violations, taken from 10 billion pesos, taken from Swiss banks, is evidence enough that the Marcoses plundered the country. Where will Congress get 10 billion pesos except from the ill-gotten wealth of Marcos transferred to the Philippines? And actually, it's not 10 billion, 32 billion pesos total was transferred to the Philippines by the Swiss banks for ill-gotten wealth of the Marcos. And that's proof enough. And there's no, even if they have billions to fund their lies, while we, or victims, of course, we don't have billions, we will subject our narrative to evidence, and we have evidence to prove this, but they cannot even have summoned the evidence to prove that they did not have ill-gotten wealth, despite the return of the Swiss banks of their ill-gotten wealth in these Swiss banks.
And of course, there's also the Hawaii class action suit in 1995. They were awarded $2 billion. Dollars. Hanggang ngayon, hinahanap pa yung pera na yun para mapondohan yung napanalunan ng mga biktima. We're going to take a quick break after the fact. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Welcome back to After the Fact. We're still joined by Manolo Quezon and attorney Neric Colmenares. Okay, so earlier we were talking about the myths and the lies about the martial law era. Okay, so at this point, let's also talk about one of the biggest lies or myths being propagated in favor of the Marcoses and martial law. The idea that there were no human rights violations during the time of Marcos, during the Marcos regime. Manolo.
Well, you know, part of the reason, again, you know, earlier we were talking about being manhid, is actually when you compare the numbers, they seem so unimpressive compared to what's happening today. But these are documented not just under the law, but in the personal experience of so many Filipinos. It is something that nearly everyone has been touched by, at the very least indirectly. We all know someone or who experienced some sort of brutality under the Marcos regime. Which is why, as we were pointing out earlier, the pivot of the Marcoses has always been to say, eh, ilan lang yan, and hindi naman sila usual suspects, diba? But at the end of the day, they can never ignore the fact that there were abuses by state forces.
And of course, there was the Human Rights Separation Act, right, 1995. So basically, that acknowledged, that's true.
The government itself, the state acknowledged, yes, and enacted it into law.
Oh. Attorney Neri.
Well, actually, that's the problem with the Marcos is saying, oh, let's move on. How can we move on? You don't even admit the fact that you violated our rights. I mean, if you ask for forgiveness from someone, you have to at least admit your sin, right? But they keep on harping no human rights violations, and we're witness to that. Christian, as I mentioned before, I was an 18-year-old kid. I was just asking for the return of student councils and school papers, which were banned by Marcos. Is the banning of student councils and school papers a historical fact? Yes. Is that a violation of rights? Yes, definitely. I was arrested. I was tortured. Oh, the book, you know, 7 days, you know, bugbog or paso ng sigarilyo, you know, corriente. They used to electrocute me here with a sort of a cattle prod here. And, all these things happened to me. And I said, you know, there comes a time after 3 days or 4 days of torture when my entire body was numb because I was kicked, I was slapped, I was, you know, my mga paso ng sigarilyo. But you know what? You become numb after a few days. Kasi wala nang pain na pwede kang magamit. But they even use mental torture on us. You know, I was an 18-year-old kid. They made me watch torture and they say, Neri, you're next. They put a man in the table. And then hinubaran nila yung lalaki, and then they inserted a wire into his penis, and I was really shocked. You know, it was bleeding, and then they connected the wire to some corriente somewhere, a dynamo somewhere, and so really it was shocking for a kid like me to witness that. It was traumatic. I forgot now the cigarette burns. I forgot now where I was kicked, but I could never forget the mental torture. One night I was taken out of my cell, brought to a room at 2 a.m. by a drunken intelligence officer. He said, okay, he emptied the revolver with all the bullets and then placed one bullet, and I saw the bullet enter the chamber, and he placed the gun inside my mouth. You know, if the gun is inside your mouth, I always say this, it's very cold. And the moment whatever you call that thing there, that the trigger that triggers it, you know, it sounds like the gun was exploding inside your mouth, and I could feel my brain shattered. And you imagine that, no? And you know, he did it twice. So that's something that, you know, I can never forget. They put M16 bullets in between my fingers and then squeeze it. So painful. Now, why would we invent such stories if it did not happen? After martial law, after Marcos's overthrow, people are still scared of the military. So you don't just concoct a lie and say, well, I was tortured by the military, I was tortured by the police. You know, you're afraid of being killed if you tell a lie, right? So, this kind of a lie that no human rights violations happen, you know, as I mentioned before, you know, people will not go out in droves in the street risking their lives if these abuses did not happen. And the Marcos says, and I'm a living witness again, and so are many others, to that atrocity, which, You know, it really broke us. And, you know, every time we talk about it, every martial law commemoration, you know, we feel very bad because there was no closure. There was no closure. No justice was done. Not the Marcoses, not the military men who tortured us. So I guess that's a lesson in reconciliation and peace. There can really be no peace without justice, because there was no justice on the enriles. There was no justice on the torturers. Therefore, they are now in the same position to come back to Malacanang. If what we did was what similar to what Germany did to the Nazis and the Holocaust perpetrators, then they would be in no position to come back in Germany. But here, we forgot about them. The government purposely, purposely refused to teach martial law to the next generation to accommodate the architects of martial law who were, you know, who, you know, formed part of government. And I think that was a really bad thing, because if there is no justice, then it can always come back. Extrajudicial killing continue to recur here. Human rights violations continue to recur because there was no closure and accountability on the part of the Marcoses and the other perpetrators.
I hope the especially the youth are listening or watching this episode, especially that very powerful account by Congressman Eric Colmenares, because I think that basically it's a powerful story that should debunk this specific lie about martial law, na wala raw human rights violations. No? Manolo, let's talk about now the resurgence of the Marcoses. Are they succeeding? And why it's important, if you are a Marcos, for one of them to again run for the presidency?
We forget that if Dandinko Huangco and Imelda Marcos had united forces in 1992, it was entirely possible they could have won the election 6 years after EDSA.
That early.
Which reminds us of one basic thing. You know, this is not, we are no longer, we have not been living for 30 years in a country where it's the democracy of the majority. Every administration since 1992 has been a minority. None has ever been elected with more than 39% of the vote. If you review the surveys and you look at the percentage of Filipinos who want a dictatorship as the solution to everything in this country, it fluctuates depending on how things are going, from anywhere from 3 to 10%, which means regardless of anything, one out of 10 Filipinos wants a dictator. That is a lunatic fringe in any country except the Philippines, because you only need 20% more to become a president with a 10% committed group like that. Not even those who vote for progressive party lists can get a total of that much and yet it's a built-in constituency. You add in other groups, the middle class that is afraid of the poor or has been conditioned to resent inconvenience. And then you can build, remember, you don't have to have a majority, you only need a minority that is just a little bigger than any other minority. And when things fall into place, for example, in 2016, if the former majority splits, then a new minority can come up and it will win. I mean, that's all it takes. In the same way that in 1992, that was how FVR won with 24% of the vote. You know, so in that sense, the Marcoses have studied, the Marcoses have invested. Everyone, you know, you talk to game developers, many of the young game developers are very loyal to Aimee Marcos because they were funding these startups a long time ago when no one else was. Once I met her in Lawag and she was telling me how she was investing in apps, and this was in 2010. They have an idea, they want redemption and they want restoration.
You see this as part of a big plan.
Yeah, well, yes, because Mrs. Marcos, they latched onto something with that documentary on Imelda in the 1990s of Abaya and Borgi becoming a model, which was, let us make the transition from political figures to celebrities. A millennial friend of mine told me, you know, the problem with you guys, pointing at me and I guess everyone my age, is for you, the Marcoses are political. For us, they're celebrities. And that is the fundamental truth that they have latched on. And the only other rival out there is what, Chris Aquino? And even there, that, you know. So my point is, we have to look at the conditions. Part of the reason that anti-Marcos people are freaked out is we are still conditioned into the old thinking that we think there is a potential majority out there. Mm-hmm. There's not. But it is an organized and committed minority that may have the key to attracting others to form a bigger, because all the rest of us are fighting with each other over ideology or old grudges or whatever.
They don't have to win the hearts and minds of majority of Filipinos.
Yes, and they know that. They knew that from the very start. Yes, in the same way that they already had the loyalty of the Warais and of the Ilocanos, and that's a great start for any political thing. You don't need the rest of the Visayas. You don't need the rest of Luzon.
Very interesting perspective. Attorney Neri, you're part of the campaign against the return of the Marcoses to Malacanang. So this group's objective is very, very specific. Are they gaining more leverage these days?
Oh, they have a lot of funds. So as you mentioned, Kalina, they were still looking for the ill-gotten wealth to additional ill-gotten wealth to be confiscated. Yeah, but we will of course fight that. I mean, lalabanan namin talaga niyan, especially if it's a tandem between Marcos and Duterte. To go back to Malacanang, no? Marcos was a nightmare. Duterte is a nightmare. So why should we have nightmares in Malacanang? I mean, I've always said any government that tortures an 18-year-old kid like me, it must be a very cruel government. Is Bongbong Marcos part of that government and must be held to account? I think so. I mean, he cannot claim that he's an innocent kid. You know, the sins of the father cannot visit the sons. Well, yeah, but you were there. Marcos, Bongbong Marcos was the governor of Ilocos Norte during the time. So I was no kid. At the time, in 1986, when the people power was there, he was in military fatigue. And he said, so it's not really, parang, you know, you were a small kid, you didn't know anything, you know. So that doesn't exonerate him at all. And so we will really fight off any attempt by the Marcoses to return.
But what should be the strategy? Yung binanggit ni Manolo kaya it's very interesting and perhaps even alarming, no? People or critics of the Marcoses look at them as political, no? Pero to the young, they are celebrities. How do you approach, in terms of strategy, the celebrityfication of the Marcoses? We've been seeing that, diba? I think this is also part of the reason why Marcoses and other political figures are veering toward the vloggers, diba? The influencers, because they can get their messages across more widespread compared to, let's say, sitting down in an honest to goodness interview with the journalists. So, I mean, how do you address that?
Yes, well, they have a lot of help from their funding. They have a lot of help from President Duterte, who considered Marcos the best president ever, and even a hero who deserves a hero's burial. You know what? We don't have the same resources as they. We just have to keep repeating our narrative and our story. And we are very inspired, Christian, because in the last few years, many of the young began to realize. Because, you know, the young people, they were not there. They're easily probably, you know, influenced by this YouTube and so social media, black propaganda. But the moment they see the truth, they begin to work and struggle against it for the return. For after all, it's their future that is at stake here. So that's probably it for me. Go for the youth and then try to explain to them, because one of the most open-minded sectors, of course, in the Philippines is the youth. So I guess old people like us who experience martial law and the new young activists here, we all have the burden of really of making the people aware, especially the youth, of what happened in martial law and what could happen to us again if the Marcoses return in Malacanang. So, we just have to, as they say, is as long as you're a monk, you keep on tolling the bell. As I mentioned, we don't have the resources to counter the narrative. What, they have 5,000, 10,000, 20,000 trolls? But we will have 50,000, 100,000 members of the youth and the activists and the opposition who can counter that narrative. And we probably can harness that, I think, because social media is a major arena now. If we can harness the 50,000, 100,000, you know, opposition and activists all over the country, the members of Makabayan and the members of Bayan Muna, then I think we can really lay out the truth there and counter these well-funded lies that are being peddled by the Marcoses. And I'm very sure we will win that. In the same way that Bongbong Marcos lost despite his money in 2016, they will lose again in 2022 because we will really be fighting this time, not for anything else, not only for the memory of martial law, but also for the commitment to ensure that it can never happen again. What happened to me, Manolo, should never happen to our sons, our daughters, and the next generation of Filipinos. That is what is at stake here. That the tortures like that and the killings like that should never be experienced by the new generation. And if only for that, we will keep on fighting despite, you know, all this support and this money of the Marcoses. And we will really, I think, in the end, truth will prevail. We will prevail there because we are on the side of the truth. We will prevail because we are on the side of the just. And we will prevail because we are on the side of the people.
Okay. Finally, Manolo, speaking of Bongbong Marcos, is it only a matter of time before he declares his presidential candidacy, that there's no other option for the Marcoses in the next election cycle but to field someone for the presidency?
Well, it's that the momentum is about to be lost. There's one quick story. A former friend of Marcos who recently passed away said the president had divided his fortune into three: one part for his wife, the second part for his children, and the third for the sole purpose of electing Bongbong president. The problem was that 2016 proved the weakness of the Marcos strategy. On one hand, a basic truth in elections is everyone wants the youth vote, but on election day, if your barkada says, let's just watch a movie, they're not going to vote. The ones who show up to vote are the old. And the thing is, the Marcoses forgot that there are still many people who have not forgotten, who are alive and are willing to vote. And at the same time, they also underestimated the fact that not all the youth are falling for their glitz on social media. That because of the old, because of the teachers and the professors and people like Nick, that there is a growing constituency also of the young with an alternative view. That makes it problematic for them because the one thing that the Marcoses have always relied on is the aura of invincibility. He was defeated with everything at his command, including a mother who wasn't senile yet at the time. He had everything going for him in 2016, and he couldn't manage it against an unknown, relatively unknown widow of all things from the boonies. It makes him vulnerable again now because, again, people have seen that he can lose and that it is possible to defeat him. It's the one thing that Marcos, after referendum in his time, was trying to disprove. He went into 1986 with the aura of invincibility and lost it. So all I'm saying is that for every strategy that the Marcoses have, we can't forget that there are also efforts to go against it, and that they're every bit as committed and probably even more committed because motivated by personal experience on the part of the elders than the Marcoses' dreams of restoration.
Okay. Manolo Quezon and Attorney Nery Colmenares, thank you, gentlemen, for joining us tonight.
Maraming salamat. Thank you, po. Good night.
So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.